Thank you for coming. So today we're going to be looking at heart rate monitoring in terms of how you can use that to assist with condition management for ME and long COVID. So with long COVID, it's only really going to help if you're post-exertional malaise. But as these sessions are kind of all about pacing, it's likely that's everyone in the audience. Now, as well as being experienced with pacing, I started using heart rate monitoring about 18 months ago. I might have that time slightly wrong because I've not added up the months very carefully. I'd first heard about it, and then I'd sort of read some things like, oh, will this work for like mental fatigue? It's got issues with mental fatigue as you know, as well as just sort of physical. So I put it to one side, and then I looked into it, found it quite hard to follow protocols. There wasn't a lot of good resources out there. Eventually, I got going and found it helpful. And I thought this is something that could benefit a lot of people, but there's not the right support out there for it. So I sort of reached out to a few people and started a research project. So if we have time, I'll talk a bit about that. But I've been running this in conjunction with the Work Well Foundation and Physios for ME and Visible and one or two others. So wealth of experience using it for myself. I've also been dealing with the technical side of a, you know, about 20 people for a heart rate monitoring project. So the core idea of heart rate monitoring is that your heart rate can be quite a good indicator of activity levels. In general, but specifically, it can be really quite good in terms of exertion and overexertion, particularly. So, there's been quite a lot of research that Work Well Foundation have, and others have done, and where it's shown that if your heart rate is over of a certain level and you have post-exertional malaise, then it's likely that that could be triggering your symptoms. And that's sort of something that it's hard to work out the exact sort of number. And Work Well have been able to do sort of 2-day exercise testing, and from that they can kind of work out what someone's number is, and that will be true whilst their health is exactly as it was then. But obviously things like that can change over time. The main way that you will use heart rate monitoring is you'll have a monitor like I've got on my wrist, and you'll set an alarm so that if your heart rate goes above a certain rate, the alarm will go off, and that will warn you that you might be doing something that could be triggering post-exertional malaise, and then potentially you can do something about it. If you stay below that level, you're less likely to be triggering post-exertional malaise. So I would stress that this isn't a cure for post-exertional malaise. But it is something that you can use that can help warn you when you might be doing things that could be triggering post-exertional malaise, and it can help in terms of management. Some people find the process of pacing very difficult, and it's hard when you don't really have anyone else to tell you what to do. It's just yourself. And one nice thing about heart rate monitoring is it's some sort of semi sort of external indicator where you might be sort of overexerting yourself. You can also, if you experience symptoms, you can then use the data that's saved in the heart rate monitor and look back at what you've done in the last 7 days, and maybe you'll get some hints that will help show where you might have done things that might be triggering sort of issues. And even when we're not just looking at what sort of could be triggering sort of post-exertional malaise in terms of general activity levels, you can get a sense of, oh, have I rested at all today? It's surprisingly accurate, often a lot more accurate than people who do activity diaries. Looking at your heart rate can often be a more accurate indicator of what you've been doing, even including mental activities. One thing I would stress, I think we've talked in previous sessions a bit about the idea of a sort of you tend to get post-exertional malaise either from doing something that's very intense or beyond what you can safely do, or the accumulation of what you're doing in a day. So an alarm won't necessarily stop you, or be quite hard to stop you doing generally too much, but it'll warn you of doing things that are individually kind of beyond what you could be doing. It is a little bit self-corrective, so if you consistently do a bit too much, then you'll find your heart rate will probably go up a bit, and that will potentially start warning you. But it's better at stopping you doing things that, playing a game of squash, for instance, or more realistically, doing a 10-minute walk, or trying to do, a small sort of physical activity. All of those can potentially be shown. So one of the key sort of advantages in sort of using a heart rate monitor is that post-exertion malaise is pretty unpleasant. It's pretty horrible. It's pretty debilitating. The more you can avoid triggering it, the better. Also, as we've talked about in previous sessions, if you're able to stay within your energy envelope and avoid triggering PEM, there is a chance that what you'll find is your amount of energy you have each day increases to a certain degree. Now, there's some people who are very much of the view that if you just, pace properly, you will make a full recovery. Evidence doesn't back that up. Many people will plateau, but most people will find that they make some improvement over time in energy levels. So that's sort of a big advantage. One thing I sort of found was that it's very hard to explain to family members and friends and work colleagues and lots of people, oh, I can't do this because I'll experience symptoms, because I'll experience post-exertion malaise, because that will be beyond what I can do. Quite often, these are quite vague sounding terms, but I found I could say, for instance, oh, if I walk the dog at the moment, that will take my heart rate to 110. It should really be no more than 98. And that's something that even my daughter, who's 8, she understands. And it's quite easy to then say, okay, we need to do things in a way that avoids that or keeps that to a minimum. And it won't work with everybody, but some people respond much better to numbers than they do to more subjective words. So it can be helpful in that context too. There are a lot of problems with, well, jumping ahead in my slide, sorry. There's a lot of problems with other ways of identifying post-exertion malaise. We're not perfect at identifying triggers ourselves. Sometimes you might think something is a trigger for post-exertion malaise. That could be another issue we're experiencing. We've got biases. I've got coffee here. I was camping last night with my daughter, so I'm a little bit tired. But having caffeine can mean that it's harder to pick up on fatigue triggers. And there's all sorts of other things that can kind of distort. Sometimes we can be so excited and pleased that we can do things finally when we've not been doing them before. We maybe kind of get adrenaline boosts. We don't necessarily see or want to see some of the triggers that might be there. And because there's a delay in experiencing PEM, and it's not like I said, it's not the set sort of, oh, it's always 12 hours. It can vary from 12 hours to 6 days. It can be hard to know exactly what to put it to. So that's some things where, a heart rate monitor can give quite useful data. If you are looking at a heart rate monitor, there's a lot of factors considering what you use. Broadly speaking, you get a lot that are on the wrist. They're the ones most people use because they're the sort of least intrusive. You get some that are on the arm, and you get some that are sort of chest bands. A lot of people find the chest bands not comfortable to wear constantly, but some people have no problem doing so. The advantage of the chest bands is if you think the heart is here, trying to take a reading from the heart here is much more accurate than basically what the wristbands do, sort of reading light and stuff passing through your wrist. It's much less accurate, although for the purposes of heart rate monitoring, it's probably sufficiently accurate for most purposes. You can also think where you're going to get something new, whether you get something secondhand. So I favour secondhand because it's a lot cheaper. This particular watch I got for maybe £15, maybe $20, and you'd be paying a little bit more. You'd be paying about four times as much, maybe, to get it new. there can be issues of software, whether you want to use the proprietary software. So this is a Garmin device, so I use Garmin Connect. You can use third-party software. Visible is an example of that, where they don't have their own devices, but you can use their software rather than the sort of software that might come with the device. And you consider whether you want the most up-to-date model or get a slightly older model that maybe is a bit easier to use. One thing to bear in mind is often the newest model is not the most accurate, because often it takes a while for software patches and everything to kick in and actually to work as well as some of the older sort of devices. But sometimes it can be more accurate because it has more features. Heart rate variability is something else that you can track. And a lot of people find that beneficial. One issue with heart rate variability is you need a much more accurate heart rate monitor to read variability. So some people will use a chest strap to take a morning heart rate variability reading, and otherwise they'll use a wrist-based device. It's quite hard to get everything you want from one device. And also these things have got other features, you might care about those. Some do sleep tracking, that can be really important if you've got sleep issues. So none of the devices at the moment are really designed for ill people to help them pace. Most software isn't either. There are a few exceptions to that, such as Visible, where it's very much designed by people with long COVID, for people with long COVID and ME. But on the whole, none of the devices are really designed for us, and there's not much software that is. So quite often what you're kind of having to do is use software and devices for a purpose that they're not intended. So a lot of the devices aren't really comfortable to wear long term, because if you're really wanting to use this, you're probably wearing one most of the day, most days, and a lot of devices just aren't comfortable for that. A lot of them have features you can't turn off, step counts that you don't care about. You almost maybe don't want to do steps. They're needlessly complicated because they've got a lot of features that you don't want to use. So there can be sort of a lot of issues. On that, I would say in the heart rate monitoring project I'm running, about 20 people have had a particular device. And for that, I've done videos guiding them through what to do. I've done written instructions guiding through people what to do. And still with that, I would say there's been about 40% have needed one-to-one support because they've had problems. You know, there are issues. I've just seen a question coming up. I'm just going to give that a quick check. So somebody's asked if you set an alarm for your heart rate right through your Garmin watch. With Garmin, what you actually do is you do turn the settings on the watch, but it's mainly done through the software, Garmin Connect, and then the watch will trigger an alarm when it sort of works. I mean, one of the issues with Garmin, for instance, just to give you an idea of some of the problems you can have with devices, it doesn't work as an alarm by default. In order for it to work, you have to pretend that you're doing an exercise activity, such as yoga, and you basically do a 24-hour or 48-hour yoga session, and whilst that session is running, then the alarm will work. However, that means some other features, which are the sort of natural, the way the phone will be set up, are kind of turned off when you're running an activity, and a lot of the data it stores slightly differently. So there are issues. But these issues, I think that they don't get in the way of the benefit, but they do mean maybe some people, it's a barrier some people might not be able to overcome without support. So in terms of advice you get, and you want reasonable accuracy, there's some devices on the market that aren't accurate enough. But there's quite a lot that are. It does need, if you're wearing something all the time, it needs moderate battery life. Now, sometimes there's not alarm in the device, and that is fine. If you're using software, it'll have an alarm that goes off on your phone, but only if you are the type of person that keeps your phone with you. I don't. I often put it down and go into another room, whatever, and it's not much use having an alarm going off in a room that you're not in. It is worth noting that you For most of these, you will need sort of some sort of Bluetooth capabilities. You'll probably need a laptop or a USB charger, and you will need a smartphone or tablet, and they need to be compatible with your phone. Just had emails today from somebody in the research project where there's compatibility issues with their phone and the device, which I'd love to sort of find a way of sorting. So there can be sort of issues. You do need to do a little bit of research to make sure that things will work out for you. I chose the Garmin 3 for my project. Now, I started it a little while ago. I probably would choose that device just now. But some of the reasons I chose was I'm buying 20 of them for, you know, where my ME group's buying 20 of them, so it needs to be affordable. So, you know, when you're multiplying something by 20, it needs to be a smaller number. It has key features. There's also sort of issue that the model app has, a thing called body battery, which a lot of people find useful, but it wasn't what we were researching. So there was a danger if we used a more up-to-date version, people would be using the body battery rather than what we're really researching, and it might distort it might distort the results. There are lots of devices on the market you can go for. I would generally favour the Vivo Smart 4 over 3 because it's just a lot easier to use, whilst basically being the same device. But you don't need to stick with Garmin. There's lots of options out there. Now, I'll go through the sort of protocols for the sort of simple ways of using heart rate monitoring for condition management. And I will say there's sub groups on Facebook that are just on heart rate monitoring, and there's a lot of other things that they do here. I'm just covering some of the very basics. I think it's easy to get kind of lost in the detail of some of these other options. And also, heart rate monitoring has been researched and has been researched adequately that I feel I can recommend it. But I don't think a lot of the very, very specific protocols some people follow have necessarily been through that sort of level of research. Just like with pacing, we've done enough research to know that pacing is kind of good, but we haven't done enough research to know, well, what things in pacing are particularly helpful, what things in pacing could be changed. So I see Emma has talked a question about the Vivo Smart 5. Speak to me separately. The low heart rate problem is sortable. It's just an example, though, of how it's not easy to set up yourself. You know, I've had about 4 people who have tried, despite my guide kind of showing how to do it, and they still have the problem. So message me privately, and I will help you through that. So I don't have the Garmin 5, I've got the Garmin 4, but the issue you're talking about is the same. The solution will be similar. So getting to the simple sort of heart rate monitoring sort of protocol, you're going to set it up so that you wear it and collect data. You don't need to have it on all the time. You can wear most devices in showers and things. I took this, took my daughter swimming earlier today. I took it with me into the swimming pool. That's fine. What you're going to need to do is find your resting heart rate. There's a few controversies around the sort of details of that. Broadly speaking, you can just leave it to your device to find it for you. Some people argue, for instance, with the Garmin, the way it works out your resting heart rate, it gets it slightly wrong. It's very easy just assume whatever, computer type data is correct, but you do sort of need to sort of check it out. But I'd sort of recommend you do your research, you buy a heart rate monitor, you set up and you wear it for a while and start collecting data. Now, quite often, if you look at the Workwell Foundation, they have a guide and they'd actually suggest you set the alarm straight away. I recommend not doing that if you're doing it yourself. Quite often, the alarm just goes off all the time, and that can be really annoying, disheartening for people. If you don't have someone you can reach out to and say, hey, this is going off all the time, is that all right? The danger is a lot of people, they would just throw the devices away and never use them again. So I recommend going through a period where you're just monitoring data. Then when you do set an alarm, you're already going to have a bit of an idea of what impact that's going to be, how in an average day, how often it's going to go off. But you can then review it and sort of adjust it as needed. In this initial period, you can see, we've talked about activity diaries in the past. the heart rate monitor will actually work quite well in conjunction with activity diary. Well, the activities you do will roughly show, you can see this is a random day for myself where I did far too much from about 9 to 12. It does give an indication of what you're doing and when you're resting. So when you're looking at your heart rate data, you can do quite a lot without using an alarm. So if you take again on this day from about 9-ish to 11, that's quite a long period where I was doing quite a lot where my heart rate was elevated. And in my case, I kind of want to be about below 98. So I can see that I had whenever I'm above that, it's for very small amounts of time, but there's still on this given day, there was quite a bit of time where I'm really doing too much. In that particular day, it was unavoidable. I think I had a medical test or something. But you can see how you can and look at that sort of data and maybe it can help evaluate what you're doing and whether you could be doing less. Another key thing to sort of be looking at is, yes, when you're looking at data, it's good to look at the peaks. Are they too high? Are they too long? Are they over threshold levels? We'll get to those shortly. But also to look at, was there enough rest? So if you look back here, I do get some good quality rest. You can't see what I'm pointing at. I'll use my mouse cursor. You can see that over here, I've got some good rest that takes place, but there was quite a bit of time there where there wasn't any rest. In that particular case, I think it was some medical appointment or something, I can't remember. It wasn't easy to avoid. But you can be then sort of thinking, is there a way I could have done things differently? So these are just some sort of examples of how you can actually then, you know, be using the data other than for an alarm, because a lot of the sort of protocols cover an alarm, but that's useful, but it's not everything you can use them for. So again, if you do find you're experiencing fatigue, you can look back what you're doing for the last few days, and you might be able to get a bit of a sense of what sort of caused it. One thing I'll say about heart rate monitoring is it's much better about physical activity than other types of activity, mental, cognitive, for instance. It does still pick up on those, and to different people to different degrees. So I found though that the rate I'm happy setting alarm to that will work for most of what I do worked much better for physical than for mental activities. So what I do is I set my alarm at a level that works for physical activities, but when I'm doing mental activities, I try to sort of occasionally have a little look at my heart rate and just see where it is. If it's 15, 20 above my resting heart rate, it's kind of letting me know I probably shouldn't be doing what I'm doing for too long, that I need to take some breaks, and I find that helpful. So I don't set my alarm for the lower rate because I think it would just go off too often for me in a way that wouldn't be helpful. And I have found that I can kind of sustain the level of activity I'm doing without having any significant crashes. So I feel like it's kind of working for me. Now, if you are setting an alarm rate, the two standard formulas you're going to see are some that are going to be based around your resting heart rate and then adding a number, normally 15, sometimes 20. Now, for this, you can get your resting heart rate by just when you wake up in the morning, see what your heart rate is before you get up whilst you're lying in bed, and then take an average over 7 days. Or you can just use the number that the heart rate monitor says. Or there's age-based formulas. Now, you'll see a number of different ones out there. The more common one you'll see will be like 220 as a base of number, but often these numbers were based around research around just men. So if you're wanting something that is more sort of gender neutral, then a version of this formula, 28 minus 70% of your age, and then times 55. Now, some people argue that the iller you are, the lower that multiple should be. So if maybe 0.5 if you're quite unwell, and maybe up to 0.7 if you're doing really well. But there's not a lot of research backing that up. That's just people's ideas. So I would kind of stick to the 0.55. However, if you're finding the alarm's going off all the time, that's a good indication that you're doing too much. But you might find, in terms of when you're thinking about what you can change in your life, maybe set the alarm slightly higher so you can focus on the more egregious breaches or the things which are going to be overexerting yourself the most. Now, whether or not you set alarm all the time, it's kind of up to you. If you don't set alarm, you're not going to get a warning, but you've kind of got to do what's right for you. A good example might be somebody might work 3 days a week. They know when they're working, they're doing far too much. They don't need an alarm or anyone else to tell them. They don't have a good way of getting out of that situation in the shorthand because they need the money. And that's the circumstance they're in. Having the alarm go off in those days may be helpful, it may be not. It might be they want to keep tracking the data for those days because that could be useful for them, but they might actually not want the alarm on because it's just telling them something they already know in a way that might not be positive. When the alarm goes off, if at all possible, you should stop the activity because you're potentially going to be doing something that's triggering post-exertional malaise. So if you can stop, great, and then rest. Now, work well, their sort of guidance recommends resting until you get within, I think it's either 5 or 10 beats per minute of your resting heart rate. I find in practice most of the time when I'm triggering my alarm, that's not possible. If I'm partway on a dog walk, I can't go and lie down and leave my dog to roam the streets. I need to kind of get home. I can sit down and rest for a bit. I can have a pause, but I can't just completely sort of rest. So sometimes you just have to carry on, but maybe do it in a more slowly, more paced way, and maybe afterwards think, is there something I could have done differently? And in some instances, is my alarm actually set to the right level? So one thing I would encourage, if people are finding the alarm goes off all the time, and you are starting ignoring it, then I think the key thing to bear in mind is that it might be the alarm set for the wrong level for you. There is a lot of like personal calibration that's required. And it's also, you know, possible that you're doing too much. I mean, most people who experience a lot of post-exertional malaise symptoms, the reason why they experience them are because they're doing too much. So it's not unlikely, but you're doing too much. But that alarm may not be helping you other than saying that you're doing too much. So it might be worth adjusting it so you can just focus on the things. You know, so some people might be doing activities where the heart rate goes up to 150. Something where the heart rate goes up to 150 is a lot more significant than it going up to 100. So, you know, it's focusing on getting some big wins that are sustainable rather than on everything. Now, a lot of people with long COVID and ME, they also have some form of orthostatic intolerance. Now, some people can have orthostatic intolerance and it won't change the heart rate, but if you take POTS, now the diagnosis of POTS is that when you stand up, your heart rate goes up by over 30. Now you can see if we're going back to here, you know, if you stand up and your heart rate goes over 30, that's going to mean every time you stand up, the alarm goes off. Even on the age-based formula, it won't quite trigger on 30 for a lot of people. If your resting heart rate is 55, 85 might not trigger it, but it gives very little room for manoeuvre. And it can create a situation where it's hard to sustain. So there is, I was speaking to Harry Leeming about this. He's one of the people involved in Invisible. There is the potential with software to set things up so alarms would only trigger if it's for more than 2 minutes on standing, for instance. That would mean you're not getting a warning quite as soon, but some people find the heart rate goes up high on standing and then stabilizes a bit. And so for those people, something like that could help. Some people, it may be a case that they just need to set their alarm a little bit higher. It's unknown whether sort of POTS type sudden increases cause PEM. So within the sort of heart rate monitoring community, there's a number of patients who think it does. So their recommendation would be that you basically try to sort your POTS out with medication and other treatment before you get the full benefits of heart rate monitoring. And in my case, I was doing heart rate monitoring. I I've had ME for 10 years and I was doing it to sort of help me with that. Partway through that, I got COVID. That became long COVID. Whilst I had COVID, perhaps unsurprisingly, the alarm would just go off all the time because I was pretty ill with COVID and anything I did was an overexertion. But after that, I developed my dysautonomia got much, much worse. So whenever I would stand, my heart rate would go up by a lot. And I definitely couldn't use the sort of resting heart rate plus 15 formula, but I still found that I could sort of get a lot of benefits from the heart rate monitoring. I just maybe had to change my uses slightly. There are other issues people can get. I think it's called SVT, I can never pronounce it. But sometimes people, just for no reason at all, their heart rate just spike by massive amounts, they'll go up to like 120 or something. If that happens to you, the alarm will go off, and it's how you are with that. If you're okay with that, you're like, well, this isn't me doing anything, I can ignore it, that's fine. But if you kind of think of you as then failing because the alarm's going off, maybe it's better not to use the alarm. I would sort of stress, heart rate monitoring is to help you. It's not something else to kind of push you down and tell you're doing things wrong. You've got to kind of use it kindly with yourself. A few sort of things I sort of learned from doing it, I sort of found I could adapt it to how I do certain tasks, like cutting grass, brushing my teeth. When I brushed my teeth, my heart rate got up to about 125. And I think I was gripping my toothbrush very tightly when I was brushing it. I was brushing very vigorously. I was standing. Now I typically will sit, I'll grip the toothbrush more gently, and it doesn't trigger. I found with walking the dog, it was going off too high. I found it basically to train the dog so she pulled less hard. I've got quite a lot of you will have seen my dog in some of these sessions because she normally makes an appearance. But she's a Great Dane and she's quite big. So doing things like training her to pull less, that really helped there. Walk a bit slower, that helps too. I did find taking my daughter to school is almost impossible without going over the threshold. So I just try not to do it too often and try to rest before and after. We've touched on a few sort of areas that can be problematic if there's orthostatic intolerance. With children and adolescents, it's not been adequately tested. So in theory, it should work perfectly. But if you think the formulas that I showed earlier, they have been tested around adults. With children, there might be a bit more calibration needed. So it may be a case of a few weeks without setting an alarm and maybe then setting a sort of a cautious alarm slightly higher and seeing how that goes. It's difficult with children because they maybe are more easily led by other people, your parents, health professionals. So it's just difficult for a range of reasons. So I would just suggest doing things sort of cautiously. And there's a lot of medications that can adjust heart rates and they can change the numbers that we're talking about. Now, Professor Davenport from Workwell, he will just, know what medication you're on. He'll make a few adjustments to the number, just use his calculator for a few seconds and he'll give you a new number. Broadly speaking, a lot of medication will change your resting heart rate, and then it's often a good starting point to kind of make adjustments. So if your resting heart rate goes down by 10, then, if you're using even an age-based number, then drop it down by 10. But you sometimes need to do a bit of experimenting to see what will work. But just know that some medication can change your heart rate, but won't necessarily change what will cause you fatigue and PEM symptoms. So you do need to be mindful of that. There's also issues with the people who are either experiencing a crash or a severe ME. Some people are of the view that heart rate monitoring can't really help them. I don't take that view, but I think the alarm is less useful because if you're in that point, everything you do will potentially be triggering post-exertional malaise, and having an alarm go off whenever you do something may not always be helpful. But still, I found working with some people with quite severe ME, that the data from heart rate monitoring still enabled me to be able to make some suggestions that could enable them to do things that were basically making positive differences. So one area I've sort of found is that most people who've had one-to-one professional support around pacing, who've had to do activity diaries, I'm of the view that a heart rate monitor potentially can reduce the amount of weeks and the need for activity diaries, because it gets a lot of that data in a way that is less effort for the patient. So I still think there's a lot of benefit in doing activity diaries, but for the most ill people, it may be that wearing a heart rate monitor that somebody else sets up could get quite a lot of those benefits. It's my belief, it's not been tested, it is something I'm thinking of exploring in some sort of research project further down the line. So I know there's a few questions in the comments, it's quite hard to get to them whilst I'm talking. I do just want to touch on a couple of resources, and then I'll sort of open up for questions. So there is a specialist Facebook group there. It's very good. They have, it's quite an old Facebook group in that it basically tries to be like an old style web-based forum as a Facebook group. It's got quite a lot of rules that are quite confusing to follow. So it can take quite a bit of effort just to actually get accepted as a member, but there's a lot of really good resources if you do join. There's a Workwell Foundation summary sheet that gives a very, very basic overview in a page on how to use a heart rate monitor. There's quite a lot of videos out there. Professor Davenport did one for Software ME Group. It's on YouTube. I'm a bit biased because I co-created it with them, but I would say it's very good. There's other videos he's done out there as well that you can look at. It's not out yet. There's a book. This is probably more for physiotherapists, but Physios for ME have got a book covering all aspects of ME management. I've contributed a case study to that, so again, I'm a bit biased. I have also put together about a 40-page document that's still a bit rough and needing some edits, but if anyone wants a copy of it, I'll probably put it into on COVID support so it can be available for people to have a look at. Bear in mind, though, it's a little bit rough because it's quite difficult editing things when you've got brain fog. And ideally, I'd want a lot more pictures in than an hour. But if anyone wants it, they can get it. I'll just stop the screen share and I will stop recording. And then I will open up